ओके इट इज स्टार्टेड।
और यू कैन सी द स्क्रीन
यस
हेलो एवरीबॉडी, माय नेम इज अभिनव एंड या वेलकम टू एंड्रॉइड स्टडी जैम्स फर्स्ट सेशन। सो आई करंटली आई एम इन थर्ड ईयर, थर्ड ईयर फ्रॉम कंप्यूटर साइंस। सो या होप वी हैव अ गुड टाइम टुडे। So first, let's talk about the current mobile ecosystem and the industry trends currently, right? I mean, the world, obviously, because of the COVID-19 pandemic, there's been a lot of differences in the way we perceive things. A lot of things went digital fast, like apps. I mean, basically apps. Apps for almost all of the things which we require, we can find most of them. When you just check out the Play Store or the App Store, you can find so many different apps which a lot of people use and for many different reasons. So looking at some of the statistics, smartphone users in India are expected to reach over 760 million by the end of 2021. And that's like a very huge number. And India is generally a mobile first market. That means whatever products companies produce, like they even take care of the mobile part while doing it. Obviously all of you know how important mobile app development is, because I mean just look at how many apps you use daily. A lot of them are very different reasons, very different apps. So it is easily one of the most efficient and effective way to connect to users, can use to engage with customers everywhere and increase your visibility basically. So again, a few statistics. With more than 2.5 billion global active devices and growing, and it continues to thrive as an innovative mobile, open mobile platform built for everyone. And you can see there's 2.5 billion active Android device users and 2 plus billion active monthly Play users, that is the Google Play, and 116 plus billion downloads over the last 12 months of different apps. Developers create amazing digital experiences for Android users across the world, that is those people who develop apps basically, yeah. So before we actually get into the actual development part, I mean most of you all might have already known, but to those who don't know, what is Android? So Android is an open source Linux based operating system, which was intended for mobile computing platforms. So it's like an operating system just like the ones we use on our laptops, Windows, Ubuntu, all of those. And Android is one which is primarily for mobile. And it is a software stack for mobile operating systems. And Android is open source. It is under development by a lot of developers. Well, because it's open source and anybody can contribute. But mostly, it's taken care by Google and the Open Handset Alliance. Open Handset Alliance is basically a group of companies which have come together to do this. And of course, you can contribute as well to the Android operating system, again, because it's open source. And so what language do people use for developing apps in Android? Basically, Java and Kotlin are the two most widely used languages. Java was first, I mean, initially it was Java, which was being used, but then Kotlin was developed a bit later after that. And as of 2019, Google announced that Android development will be increasingly Kotlin first, which means that whatever libraries Google develops, they'll mostly be in Kotlin rather than Java. What is Kotlin? Kotlin is basically just another programming language, just like Java or C++. It's just a little bit more statically typed language. It's more expressive, and it is very handy when you want to develop apps for Android. But you can use it elsewhere as well. But primarily, it's used in Android. It was first like introduced in 2010 by JetBrains. JetBrains is also the team which built the IDE called IntelliJ, which is Android Studio is built upon this IntelliJ. And I think they've sent me Android Studio installation, but I mean, we don't require it for this session, but be sure to do that later at least. So yeah, Kotlin is also an open source language. It's free open source and has been used by over 5.8 million developers. Again, since it's open source, you can check that out as well, how it's written, and you can contribute as well. So this is a survey taken by Stack Overflow. If you don't know Stack Overflow, it's like a community for programmers where people post questions and anybody can answer, basically. Yeah. So as you can see, Kotlin is one of the most loved languages. You can see that Rust, TypeScript, Python, Kotlin. It's gaining a lot of popularity, and very soon. So this is one example of Kotlin usage. Flipkart was an app first developed by Java, because like, that was the only way you could develop using Java. And but once they shifted to Kotlin for most of their functioning, it took 20% less time spent on build stabilization, and they required 30% less code for the entire app compared to Java programming language. 30% less code, and so that means saving time spent on code reviews and maintenance. That is something you learn later, but yeah, as you can see, 30% less code, 20% less time. This was told by the Android tech lead on Flipkart during an internal survey. 50% of developers mentioned that they provide smaller estimates to complete a feature if the module was written in Kotlin. So yeah, as you can see, Kotlin has become very important in the Android development world, and it's important that so today's session will primarily focus on Kotlin itself rather than the actual development. And these are some of the stats for Kotlin and Android in 2021. The top 1,000 apps are on Play Store. Out of that, 70% contain Kotlin code, and 60% professional Android developers use Kotlin. And these are some of the Google apps which use Kotlin. As you can see, Drive, Maps, Play Store, Google Pay. 60 of the Google apps use Kotlin, and it's increasing. So coming to what are Android Study Jams? Android Study Jams are like computer community organized study groups for people so that they can learn hands-on. So they can learn Android app development using hands-on learning. So it has different tracks, and Android Basics is one of them, which focuses especially on learning how to build Android apps without any prior Android experience. So this will be one of the basic session. You don't really require anything before the session. So yeah, these are some of the things, opportunities you get from ESJ. That is Android Study Jams. You can learn the basics building Android apps, solve real-world problems, develop a collection of simple apps, and you can certify yourself as an Android developer as well. And after this sessions, you can deploy one app on Google Play as well. So how do you start? To begin with, you need to create a developer profile on Google. You can do this either right now or after the session. So basically just like type on your Google creator, Google developer profile, or you can just I'll share you this URL later, and you can click on that, create a profile. So why do you need a developer profile? as I told, there'll be different tracks, right? Different tracks you can complete. By tracks, I mean different kind of lessons you can complete. And with each of those tracks you complete, you earn badges. And that is a good way to showcase your achievements and share your achievements. And and you learn as well. Like if you go on your actual roadmap kind of thing, which they have, and it'll be a very good learning experience as well. So yeah, this is how the track kind of looks. There'll be a few units, and in each of those units, there'll be different pathways. At the end of that pathway, there'll be quiz on what you've learned. After that, after you complete that quiz, you get the badge, and that is shown on the developer profile. So yeah. So today's learning objectives will be basically learn the basics of the Kotlin programming language. I'll share you a few resources to continue learning Kotlin. And at the last, we'll just go through a few basics of Android Studio, the structure of it all, and just a few basics basically. We're not building something, but I'll just show you the IDE and the environment where you write code. So yeah, let's get started with the Kotlin part. In your browser, right, just type Kotlin playground. And click on the first link. This is like an online compiler provided by Kotlin, and you can write anything you want and you can run anything you want. You can just see it for now or try it out for yourself, but let's start by doing some very simple thing like IntelliJ. You can run it by clicking this, and you see the output here. So let's just see what's actually happening here. You all might have had C or C++ during your first year, and then I think since the third semester is complete, the CS students might have had data structures as well, I think. So you might be familiar with C, at least all of you. So in C, right, if you want to write a function, or you do something like add something and do this, right? Here also in Kotlin, to indicate a function, you use the keyword fun. That means it's a function. And main is similar to the main you have in C, that's like the main function. So execution starts from here. Inside the curly braces again, you have the function body. And println is a keyword you use to print something. And hello world, whatever you want to print, you put it in double quotes inside these parentheses. And one thing about Kotlin is you don't need semicolon. Like you can put semicolon, nothing's gonna happen, but you don't need semicolon in Kotlin. So there's that. Next, you can just down on this, I guess, like print function, just print something without leaving a line, without going to the next line. So if you do this, you get add here, but because it's only print, it doesn't go to the next line, and it just prints hello world on the same line. Declaring variables, right? In C++, you do something like int a is equal to something. If you want to declare a as the integer type and you want to store 8 in it, you do something like this. But in Kotlin, you use a use a keyword called val, and you type the name of the variable val a is equal to 8. Val a is equal to 8 means variable a holds the value 8. So if I print a, it's going to show 8. And you don't need to specify the type of the variable a is going to be. So you can just write anything like here. Yeah, that means a is going to store a string variable, string integer. I mean, string a is going to hold string. So it doesn't. If you do this, you don't need to mention what kind of data type a variable can hold. But if you want to, you can do that as well. And the way to do this is you write this. And this, that means a is a type. A is a string type. So if you like do this and do this, you're gonna get an error. Type mismatch in for type is string, but it was expected. So yeah, if you mention, so you don't have to mention the variable, but if you do mention, you'll have to store that variable itself. So yes. Another thing is another keyword to store variable is called var, var b is equal to, let's say, 7. Now, and b, and 7. But the difference between val and var is you cannot change the value stored in a in val type. So you cannot change the value stored in a. So now if I write a is equal to 8, and if I try to run it, I get an error. Val cannot be reassigned, but the same. Now the same. If I try with B, I won't get an error because var type can be changed. The value of var can be changed. So you've seen that. There's another thing called late tenant. This is a keyword also you use before storing variable. Like if you type late tenant var a, if you type this before a class, I will see that later. If you type that before a class, it means you're specifying Kotlin that for variable a, you're going to store a value later sometime. You're not initializing it right now, but you are going to initialize it later at some point. That's, you don't need to worry about this. Just forget it. Next, what we can see, we can see conditional statements. Conditional statements are again just the same things as C++, like if p is 7. Friend e is greater than 7. Else e is less than 7. Do this and run it. You get p is greater than 7 because p is 8 here. Like, once you reassigned it, because p is 8 and p is greater than 7, print b greater than 7. So you get b greater than 7. So that condition statement is the same basically. One more thing I want to show is you can print how to print a variable, right? Like, you can do that println b obviously, but there is this other way also. The value stored in s. If you put a dollar sign and you write b, that means it's not gonna. That means it's going to print the value stored in b. So you run this and you get the value stored in BC. You can do this or just put a curly brace around it also. Value stored in BC. So if you want to store lists, right, a list of something, so let's say while e is equal to, you can do list of, and in that you can write the list of and you run it. Oh, I'm sorry, you need to do this. Sorry, he is already mentioned. As you can see, yeah, that shows A, B, C. Oh, that error was because A was already initialized, so. This is how you store lists. There are other ways as well, but this is one of the ways. Now, loops are the same as well. Let's see, for an I is equal to this now. Then, it's the same. I'm sorry. Something's wrong. Okay. Another thing is called when. Let's say B, right? When is something like switch. When is something like switch. So remember in switch, you used to put like a variable and check with cases if something is equal to something. So here, let's say when B, right? If you put like when B is 7, you do this and you do something like this. Then B is 7. Now, if you want to check if B is 8, you can do something like this. Then B is 8. So, and if you want to check if it's nothing of these two, then you print ln B is not 7 or 8. Now you do this and run this. You want to get B is 8 because B is 8. So, this is something like switch case, but for Kotlin. Next we'll see some other functions. Like I said, to write functions, you use this one and fun. And what function can you add? If you want to return something, you write it like this. You don't write it before the function, like in C++, you write it afterwards. Now, A plus B. So, if I call this function from here, then sum 8,9. Now I run this, and you get 17. Yes, so this is function, but you can do this as well. When all you have is a single line function, you can do this. So A and I is equal to A plus B. You can do something like this as well, instead of writing it all in curly braces, and it will still work. See, A plus B, 8, 9, 8 plus 9, you get 7. Now, what else can we check here? That for thing will be something like this. Let's say I don't initialize it like that. I then I think this will work. Yeah, this is working. Try 1 to 10 and then dial in I. So that was for. So yeah, these are the like the basic things you need to know to Bob and Kotlin. We can do classes as well. So you have like a class called student. And say there's a do this and so these are like the default values you can input. So basically this means that it's a student class. I mean, it's a class of a student which will hold two variables. So yeah, so that is how we can write class. And here you can write constructor as well, or similar to Java, but I mean Java C++, but here instead of constructor, it's something called init. This is in constructor in C++ basically means that is the first function which gets called when you create an object of the class, right? Here init also means the same thing. This is the first function which will get called when you create an object of a student, let's say. So that was Kotlin. I think that much will be enough, but try to like just play around with all of this and I'll share you the code labs later so you can read from that as well, but for now let's continue the next part. So after Kotlin, let's see why people prefer Kotlin, why developers like they start using more Kotlin and they prefer it over Java. To those of you know Java, right? If you want to write a class with getters and setters, what you do first is you initialize the variables. You initialize the variables, name and age, and you declare them, and this is the constructor where you initialize these variables. Then get name or your return name, set name means you set the name, get age and set age. And similarly, you override the equals function and you override the hash function. But all of this, you can just write this one line, and that would be enough. So as you can see, Kotlin significantly reduces the code required to do the same functionality. So that's why people prefer Kotlin, and it's getting more use cases as we go. And these are some of the other reasons why people prefer Kotlin. As you saw last time, there's shorter program for the same task, easy code. And another important thing is Kotlin is compatible with Java. That means you can write some kind of Kotlin code within your Java project and it would still work. Similarly, you can write some Java code within your Kotlin project and that would also work. Next is eliminating null references. This you'll understand as you go further Android development. Null references basically means your app, right? You're running something and it asks for a variable. It asks for some functionality on an object, let's say. Let's say you have the student object here, and this is your app running. Now this app calls for student.getName, let's say that. But if the student object is null, right, this getName cannot function, because this getName is basically calling getName from a null object. Null object means there's nothing. You're asking getName from nothing. So that would give out an error and your app would stop. So Kotlin is that is a null reference. Kotlin Kotlin significantly helps reduce these null references. You learn them later, as you go on, how null references occur and how Kotlin reduces them. Solution to some of Java's flaws. I'll just show off this null references thing once. Let's say s. You put a question mark here, right? That means s can hold null variables. So if you don't put a question mark, that means s cannot hold null. But now it can hold null. This s can hold null. Now if I remove this, get an error, because null cannot be the value of a non-null type string. So what this means is that whenever you're writing code, right, if you want some variable to not be null, that means that means your student object in the example I've given before, right? So if you don't put this question mark, that means it cannot be null. So what Kotlin does is this, it checks during the compile time itself. So compile time, in the sense, C++ during compile time, it releases and compile errors. So what Kotlin does is, whenever you don't put a question mark and there's a probability that this variable holds null and you're calling something on this, so there is a chance that your app may call something on a null object. So what Kotlin does is it shows this error during compile time itself so that you can fix it before running the actual app. Using Java, this is not possible. And so sometimes it may happen that you're running the app and you call on null and the whole app stops. So that's why Kotlin is used, like it helps in that case. So those are some of the reasons why people prefer Kotlin over Java. I just thought I'll explain you how Kotlin compiles, right? Like if some of you might have already known, but how Java compiles, I think most of you already know, but if you don't, like you write the .java code and you compile it using the Java compiler. This Java compiler converts this code into something called bytecode. And this was like one of the main reasons why Java became extremely popular, because of this bytecode. I think some of you might have heard it was called Bora, like write once, run anywhere, because this bytecode could be run anywhere after writing the code and compile. After you get the bytecode, it could have been run anywhere. So that was the reason Java became very popular. But anyway, this class, dot class, is the bytecode. This goes into the interpreter and you get the machine code and it runs. So that is how like Java compiles. What Kotlin does is you have the .kt file, that is the extension for Kotlin. And this .kt file goes into the Kotlin compiler and this also releases a bytecode. So as you can see, like why Kotlin and Java are so intertwined, because even after Kotlin gets compiled, it gets to the bytecode and follows the same functionality. It follows the same route as what Java does. So yeah, so that's what happens to the code once you compile it. Now we'll just check out Android Studio once. If you haven't installed, I think there was a mail giving you the link to install, but I'll just do it from there later. So this is a screen which opens once you open Android Studio. It might be a little different. I think like I've used the dark mode, but I think if you're opening for the first time, it will be light mode, but I'm not sure. But yeah, this is what opens. Here, what this means is inheritance. Like in Java, right? Or in Java, if you know, if you want to inherit some function, you do something like this: class first, instance second. This means that the first class inherits methods from the second class. Here, instead of extends, you use this colon. This colon tells us that this main activity is inheriting methods from the class called app compat activity. If you don't understand like what all these are, like don't worry, because we've still not yet started the actual development. We'll start that in the next session, but I just thought to just show you all of this. On create, like you can see function, right? Function means this on create is a function. Now override means there is a function in app compat activity, which there is a function in app compat activity called on create, and that already has some kind of functionality. But once you use override, this means that you can change the functionality for the on create for your main activity. Okay, so if you've not understood this, let's say let's say there's this class called second, and in that you have a functionality called add, which takes in two numbers and that gives a plus b. But now if you are inheriting this second class from the first class, that means this first class can access add function. And now when you override this function, override add a comma b, you can introduce your own functionality for this add function. So let's say you put a into b. Now if you call add from the first class, that means it won't do a plus b, it would do a into b. So that is the use of override. Now set content view means it just sets a view that I'll explain more in detail tomorrow. So this is the main activity. Main activity generally means this is the first screen which opens when you run the code on your first screen which opens on the app when you run the code. Activity main.xml. So this .xml code is what you write for your view. Like this is how the app screen is going to look. I'll explain more about this layout thing in detail. So, but basically layout means this holds some views within itself. So here text view means, as your name suggests, you're displaying a text. And this is what you're displaying, hello world, and change that. And that is going to change on the app screen. Hello, as you can see, I'll explain this, all of this later, or latest in our tomorrow session. But yeah, so this is how it's going to look, and you can run this on an emulator, which is already there, which is already provided by Android Studio, or you can connect your phone using a USB cable, and you can run the app directly on your phone as well. All of this also I'll explain more in detail in the next session. But yeah, so this is how it's going to look, right? This com.example.asj. ASJ is the name of the app I've used, or you can use any app later. Like if you want to create a new app, go to file, click new and new project, and for now you can just start with empty activity and then click next and write the name of the application you want. Select the language is Kotlin. In here you can put the location where you want to put the app and then click on finish. So that would create the app. Like Android Studio is basically the IDE used to create IDE used to write code for Android development. I mean, you can use any other IDE as well, but this is more like created for Android development because it has some built-in functionalities like this run app and all of that, where you can run apps basically. So that, and this res means resources. It has like a few resources, like this is like a background image, all that. Layout means as I've told you, right, activity main is the layout. Layout means it tells, it shows the screen basically, like what you want on the screen, you write it in activity main.xml and .xml, as it suggests, you use XML to write it here, not Kotlin or Java. Webmap has a few images, like this launcher.png. It has a few images in here. And values, it stores the values for colors, store some string values. And here are the themes. This you'll learn more later. This is like Gradle scripts where I mean, this also you'll learn more, but this is where this is the app. This is how the app runs, like using Gradle. It builds on Gradle. Manifest has some other functions as well. So yeah, this is Studio basically. But that was it. But I'll just show you the code labs and how you can do those different courses. So on your search, Android Basics in Kotlin course, and this is provided by Google itself. Click on the first link. So yeah, welcome to the Android Basics in Kotlin. This course you learn the basics of building Android apps with the Kotlin programming language. And as you can see, this is one track, like the Android Basics in Kotlin course is one track. And you have two units, or you have more down in this. Unit one is Kotlin Basics and unit two is layouts. Kotlin Basics, so you want to learn, one second. Kotlin Basics, you want to learn basic Kotlin programming and how to use it in your Android apps. As you can see, you can earn like 4 badges from this introduction app, build a basic layout and nice layout. Layouts is, it's going to explain more in depth of the layouts which I've shown you, right? How to build all of those. UI is called, UI means user interface. So user interface is like the screens which you see on your app. Navigation means moving from one screen to other, like every app you've used, right? Generally, it moves from one different screen to other. So to do that, you'll have to use navigation. And that is also one of the unit. Connect to the internet is one of the unit. Data persistence, that means keeping an app working with other instances. So how to do that you learn, and then others work manager, that is like the last unit. So basically this is part of the Android Basics in Kotlin course, and that is what we're going to do. So now we have seen basics in Kotlin, but do this as well, like first create your developer profile and complete this Kotlin basic course. Kotlin basics, you just do introduction to Kotlin. Like the app building will do in tomorrow's session. After that, there'll be more sessions which I will cover the other units. But for tomorrow's session, it'll be like this itself. You'll do this first app and build a basic layout. All of that you'll do tomorrow. For now, but today, what you do is you install Android Studio. Like Android Studio. Windows or whatever you use, whatever operating system you use. Wait, sorry, not Android apps, like Studio. Go to this link by Develop Android, the first link itself, and download Android Studio. This is for Windows, and if you want for Mac, you can download that as well. And this itself, you'll have a lot of instructions on how to install and all of that. So go through that. After completing that, just finish this introduction to Kotlin part and get familiar with Kotlin. You can write more code here and all of that. Get familiar with Kotlin, and if you want, you can like start building some apps, or we'll do that tomorrow itself. And that was it. You have any questions to ask? Are there any questions? Can I pass it to you? Okay. Yeah, do you have any questions? Anyone?
We can. Wait for five more minutes, maybe. Okay, I think we have a question in the Q&A section. Why will XML be preferable? Okay.
That is the only way you can do that. Like XML is the language to write activities. I mean, it's like very easy compared to writing it using C++ or something else, because that would be very, very difficult. Like all this XML stuff, right? Like the text view which you saw or image view, all of that is already coded. So you can just include that text view and just write the text or something. You'll see more why how easy that is in tomorrow's session. But recently, right, Android, they have released something called Jetpack Compose. And with that, you don't even need XML to code activities, and all of that you can code using Kotlin as well. But that is like a little bit advanced, and you can learn that later. But for now, XML is pretty easy. Like I'll show you how to code it tomorrow, and you only see how very easy that is. For now, it's like, why XML in the sense, like, that is how you code. Like, that is a defined way of how you code, how you write UI for Android.
One more question.
Yeah, okay. So how we avoid null references using Kotlin? Okay. So wait, I'll share my screen. Here, right. Let's say you want to let's say there's a class called and it has something called so the student class has name and roll number. Now, let's say you're calling this class from somewhere else. Let's say you're calling this class from somewhere else, right? Like, let's say you have a student object, val student. Now, if you do like student dot few initialized values here as well, like student. So you do this. So this means, I haven't written the full code, like how you initialize, but you get the gist of it, right? This means in student object, you're having name with Abhinav and roll number 55. So when you do student.getName, this means you're going to get this value Abhinav. But if there's like a student one object, which has not been initialized. Now, if you call getName on this, you're calling getName on a null object, right? You're calling getName on a null object. If this was in Java, this code would get compiled without any problem. If this was in Java, this code would get compiled without any problem. So this means nothing, you won't get an error when you compile and you run this app. But when the app is running and when this code gets called, this now we could return an error because you're calling getName on a null. How you understood it, right? So like there's an app running here. There's no error in this if you run it in Java, and there's an app running here. There's like a button here which asks getName. So when this button is pressed, this code is called, let's say. So now there will be an error because you're calling getName on null object. But what Kotlin does is you can do something like while student one student question mark. If that was Java, right? Now let's see what Kotlin does. You write the same code in Kotlin. Now what Kotlin does is it checks at compile time itself. That means when you're compiling itself before running the app, it checks if this value is null. It checks if you've initialized it anywhere or you're going to initialize it somewhere in the future. It checks that, and if it is not null, then only it compiles and then only runs the app. So that means when you're running the app and you clicked on the button to get this name, because Kotlin has already checked that it is not null, it won't return any error. But if it is null, right? In Java, what happened was the code got compiled without any errors. But in Kotlin, this code would give an error at compile time itself. Before the app runs itself, it gives an error saying that the student one is null and you cannot call getName on that. So then what we as developers, we can like check it and see why it's null and we can change it. So yeah, that is the reason, like you understood, right? Okay.
Any more Okay, I think it is all, and we can end the session, I think.
Yeah, have any other things? Okay, so what you do is for now, I mean, what you people do is install Android Studio, right? Just install Android Studio and go through the instructions given here. I mean, follow the instructions while downloading Android Studio. After that, you can try a bit more Kotlin and you can check the Kotlin documentation itself. Kotlin docs. This is the official documentation given by
Abhinav. Actually, the screen is not
okay.
Shared, yeah. Okay.
One second. Like, yeah, type in Kotlin docs, and this is the official documentation given by Kotlin. And you can go through this as well. This is also written very well, and you'll understand everything clearly. Like basic syntax, Kotlin, for example, all of this. You'll understand more. Like, it's written very good. It's written very well. You can learn this as well. Go through this. And download Android Studio, like follow the instructions given here. And from here, like I said, just do this introduction to Kotlin. As you can see, there's different pathways. Do this pathway, like introduction to Kotlin, you do this. You can do the others as well, but in tomorrow's session, we'll be doing this, like create your first app and build a basic layout, and this as well. So we'll be doing all of this tomorrow. You can do this today as well, or you can wait for tomorrow and do that. But for today, just try to complete this so that you'll be more familiar when we're doing all of this, and it'll be easier to understand. And yeah, those three you do. And that's all. If you have anything else, that's all.
Okay. Thanks, Abhinav, and everyone. We will meet again at 11 a.m. On the next day. Okay, so I'll stop the recording and